You have access to authority. You have access to so much because of what Jesus purchased for you. Do not waste it just because you didn't know. I'm glad you guys are joining me this evening for part three of our power and authority conversation and topic. But really, I love getting to do this, you know, and I've said this before that our, you know, the gospel, the message of the gospel will never change. However, our methods will, as we continue to evolve and as we continue to navigate these seasons. And so I'm just excited that you guys are watching. So last week we were talking on the topic of power and authority. What is this power and authority that God has given us as children of God, you know, and what about this power and authority? And so what spurred these topics was that God really pressed in my heart, Val, before people can even know what to do with this power and authority, before people will even know what it is for, they first have to know three basic but very powerful truths. One is this. The first night we talked about who you belong to, whose you are. And friend, we talked about how you belong to God and how sometimes our perspective of God can be skewed because of the narrative. Maybe we know this God of religion. Maybe we know this God of judgment. Maybe we heard about this God from a grandparent, or, you know, we heard about this God from social media or whatever. But no, it is about you belonging to this God of love, this God who has plans to prosper you, not to harm you, plans for hope and a future, a God who is interested in the details of your life, this God who is coming after you, this God who sent his one and only son to die for you because he wanted a relationship with you. A song that I love, and it says, he didn't want heaven without us. That is this God of love. He did not want heaven without you, my friend. That is the God we belong to. And the second point was this, the second night was who you are. Who are you? I like to do the hand motions, who you belong to, who you are. And then tonight we're gonna talk about what you've been called out to do. But who are you? And friend, that night we talked about that you are found in Christ. Your identity is in Christ. You are fearfully and wonderfully made. You are no accident to God. You know, before you were born, he knew you. It says that he formed you. He loved you. He set you apart. He had a purpose and a destiny that was literally, that is all your own. You are the apple of his eye. This is a God that loves you so much that he created you a certain way. Your identity is not found in your finances. Your identity is not found in your marriage. Your identity is not found in just the things of this world. No, your identity is rooted in the person of Jesus. That is who you are. You are called to be a world changer. Which brings me to point number three tonight, which is what have we been called to do? What is this all about? And so friends, I want you to know that with all this power and authority that God has given you through his son, you have been called to be a reconciler back to Jesus. We are called to reconcile men back to Jesus, humanity back to the Father. That is what you've been called to do. It might look different based on your job, based on your season, but that is what you've been called to do. That is the purpose of your life and destiny. It's again, always gonna look different, but you are called to be the bridge. You are called to be the conduit back to Jesus, back to God. And so tonight I wanna start off in 2 Corinthians 5:18-20. It's found in the Passion Translation. It says this. This is going to be, we're going to catapult from this passage right here. It says, "And God has made all things new and reconciled us to himself and given us the ministry of reconciling others to God." In other words, it was through the anointed one that God was shepherding the world, not even keeping records of the transgressions. Hallelujah. Amen. Right? Come on. And he has entrusted us the ministry of opening the door of reconciliation to God. We are ambassadors. of the Anointed One who carry the message of Christ to the world, as though God were tenderly pleading with them directly through our lips. So we tenderly plead with you on Christ's behalf. Turn back to God and be reconciled to Him. Come on, that's so good. You were called to proclaim the gospel, the good news of Jesus back to humanity. That is what we're called to do. That is the honor and the privilege that we have with doing real life with people, doing real life in our communities, doing real life in our marriage, doing real life in our schools, doing real life online like this. That is what we're called to do. And I love how this verse says that God has given us this ministry of reconciling others back to Him. What an honor and privilege, right? That God would entrust humanity with all our imperfections to be conduits of His love, to bring people back to Him. And what I love is that in all of this, God sets the generations. There is a reason, friend, and a purpose for why you were born for a time such as this, in a generation today, for this generation. You are a part of a specific group of individuals that will never be together again to do something that God has specifically called us to do collectively. And I love that thought. God could have, He plucked you out of eternity and could have placed you at any other time, but no, He chose you for this, for a time such as this. He plucked you because there's something, my friend, that you bring to the table. There's something, the way that He fashioned you and wired you and created you. There's a sphere of influence that only you can minister to back to Jesus. It's so crazy, right, to think about it. That's how big your purpose is. You could have been put in any other family. You could have been born in any other country. You could have been born in any other city, any other state, any other church. But no, you are here joining me in 2020 online. That's designed by God. God doesn't design accidents. No, God is the God of intentionality and purpose. There is nothing new under the sun to God. So this, as a collective generation, we are called to rise up. We are called to do something, especially now with how crazy things seem to be going and the elusiveness. There is something, my friend, the way that God purposed you and fashioned you, that you are called to do in a time such as this, that is full of so much hope, so much purpose to bring people back to Jesus. We are called to show this generation, again, our world, our community, our sphere of influence, Jesus. As a son and daughter of the Most High, you have been given power and authority to bring glory down to all generations. You are called to be conduits of love. You are called to be conduits for Jesus to work in and through you, right? You are called to represent the King, and you have been authorized and empowered to speak on His behalf. We are called to serve wherever God has us. And we are called to serve not perfectly, friend. We are called to serve purposefully. Because that can seem like a very big mandate for some of us. Like, oh my God, Val, I'm just trying to get my own life together. I'm not, you know, how am I gonna minister, friend? God is the great, I call it my gap maker. Jesus, the grace of Jesus is my gap maker. I am not called to walk out this purpose and this life with perfection. I am called to walk up my purpose and destiny purposefully with intention, knowing that my God has got me. My God has got my back. My God is working out all things for my good and for His glory. That is my job. That is my mandate to walk this out. And I love what it says in Ephesians 2:12. It says, "We have become His poetry, a recreated people that would fulfill the destiny He has given each of us." Each of us, for we are joined to Jesus, the Anointed One. Even before we were born, God planned in advance our destiny and the good works we would do to fulfill it. Do you hear that language? God planned in advance our destiny and good works we would do to fulfill it. Friend, that should scream to you, God is in control. Even our mistakes, even our mishaps, even the turns of life, God still had it planned out. I always love to say, Jesus was never plan B. You know, well, Adam and Eve messed it up really bad, you know, really bad. What are we gonna do? Well, send Jesus. No, Jesus was always plan A, always. Again, nothing new under the sun to God. He's got all of our humanity taken account for. And I love it. This generation and every generation, can I tell you, is desperately seeking the same thing. We all have this deep need for love, significance, meaning, and we're wanting to belong, no matter what generation you're from. We all have the same need, right? We want to know that we belong to something. We want to know that we're accepted. We want to know that this life is made for something more. We want to know that there's more to life. We want to know that, God, can you utilize me? God, is there more to this? God, is there a higher purpose? Yes, friend. Man, being a conduit for the love of God is a powerful thought, powerful concept that he would use us, man, to bridge that gap, to bring people along, to bring hope to those who need it, to bring love to those who feel abandoned, to bring restoration. That is us. We get the privilege of doing that because at the end of the day, no money, no status, no Facebook friends, no amount of Instagram followers, no job, no degree, nothing will satisfy the purpose and relationship we're so desperately craving. The only one that can do that is Jesus. Jesus can satisfy that. Jesus gives us purpose. Jesus gives us our identity. Jesus reminds us of who we belong to. Jesus reminds us of our value and our worth. And what I love is that when you follow Jesus, two things always are the byproduct of this: fruitfulness and fulfillment. If we choose to walk out the calling and purposes on our lives, those things are inevitable. We feel fulfilled. We're walking out our calling. We're walking out our passion. We're walking out the things that God has called us to do. We feel fulfilled, and then we're fruitful. We're fruitful. We're actually changing the world around us because we're following the things of God and what he's called us to do. Because again, your gift is not just for you, the way God fashioned you, the way God wired you. It's always for others to change the world, to change a generation, to change your marriage, to change your finances, to change your community, to raise up world changers if you've got kids. This generation is saturated with info and the ability to feel connected, right? And yet this generation is desperately seeking purpose and a sense of belonging. They want real relationship, not religion. They want real relationships. This is a generation that is seeking purpose, seeking a place to belong, value and worth. And I want to read you something in Isaiah 61, 1 through 2. And this chapter is titled, The Lord's Message of Freedom. It's also found in Luke 4, 18 through 19. But I'm going to first read it out of Isaiah, and it says this: The Spirit of the Lord is on me, because the Lord has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives and freedom to the prisoners. And I want to read it to you actually in the Passion Translation, because when I read it in Luke, I was thinking, oh God, you are so good. Started totally nerding out because it just spoke to me in this translation as well. It says, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, and he has anointed me to be hope for the poor, freedom for the brokenhearted, and new eyes for the blind, to preach to the prisoners, you are set free. I have come to share the message of Jubilee, for the time of God's great acceptance has begun. It is now. It is now for you, my friend. That is how good God is. It has happened now. People need to hear that. And how good is that? That I get to be new eyes for the blind, those who can't see Jesus, those who can't see hope, those who can't see restoration, those who can't see a better tomorrow. We get to be the new eyes for that. We get to be hope. We get to proclaim the freedom of God. That's how good it is. The Spirit of the Lord is upon you and me. The Spirit of the Lord God anointed me, or chose you is another way to say it. The Spirit of the Lord God sent me. He sent you, friend. He sent you. In other words, this God's power and authority empowers us to do for the world around us, to do this for the world around us, to be the eyes for the world around us, to be the hope for glory around us, to be the light for others around us. That's what the power and authority gives us for others when we're talking about what we've been called to do. We have the same power that rose Jesus Christ from the dead, friend. It lives and dwells within us. And on top of that, we've been given the authority as a child of the Most High so we could be conduits of God's love on God's behalf. And to do what? To bring good news to the poor. How many of you guys know somebody out there in your sphere of influence who is poor in spirit, who needs to know that they are valued, who needs to know that there is hope, who needs to know that they are valued, who needs to know that God sent a son, his one and only son, to die for them, who needs to know this God who will come running after them, who needs to know this Jesus who would leave the 99 for them, who would leave the 99 just for one, for you and for me? Who out there, who is poor in spirit and needs to know that Jesus, this Jesus that forgives, this Jesus that heals, this Jesus that heals people of cancer, heals people of disease, someone who needs to know this Jesus that can heal their marriage, that can fight for them, this Jesus that restores, this Jesus that redeems, this Jesus that has good news. Come on, somebody. Someone out there is poor in spirit, and you get to be that conduit. You get to pray for them. You get to share with them this amazing news. That's what we get to do. And then it says to heal the brokenhearted. Friend, do you know someone out there who's brokenhearted? Someone out there, maybe there's someone whose marriage is falling apart due to all this COVID stuff. I keep hearing in the news that because we're bunched together for such a long period of time, that there's been more domestic abuse. There has been more verbal abuse, mental abuse, because spouses that are having to stay together, quarantine for so long. Even child abuse has gone up. Friend, do you know somebody who is brokenhearted at the state of their marriage, at the state of what's going on in their finances? You get to bring good news. You get to heal the brokenhearted. That's the kind of power that God has given you, to heal. How about to proclaim liberty and captives and freedom to the prisoners? I'm not just talking about literal prisoners. No, another translation says, or to announce freedom. Who needs freedom from addiction? Who needs freedom from alcoholism? Who needs freedom from the bondage of pornography? Who needs freedom from maybe compulsive lying, or from an eating disorder, or maybe from pride? Who needs freedom out there? Who needs to know this God that breaks chains, who breaks the bondage, the yoke of bondage? Who needs to know this Jesus? Who out there is dealing with mental depression? Who needs to know this God who is there, who can help them with the oppression? Maybe thoughts of suicide. Somebody needs to know. And someone, God will send someone to you. That way you can help them. You can proclaim that they are free in the name of Jesus. That Jesus is freedom. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom for them to overcome. They can be overcomers in Jesus and overcome these addictions, overcome the thoughts of suicide and mental depression. A lot of the times people keep that hidden and in secret, but God knows. God sees you. God sees them. And we get to be the conduits of that love. We get to be the gap, to help bridge that with Jesus as our gap maker. Someone out there needs to hear that. You know, and it also says to comfort those who mourn. Friend, do you know someone right now who's mourning loss? Who's mourning the loss of a parent? Who's mourning the loss of a relationship? Who's mourning the loss of a child? Maybe who's mourning the loss of a dream? Because with COVID happening and things shutting down, maybe they lost a business. Maybe they have great financial loss. And now they're mourning. The Bible says we rejoice with those who are rejoicing, and we weep with those who are weeping, or we mourn with those who are mourning. Some people are losing their lives. Who do you know that you can be that, you can be that comforter, you can come and comfort. Again, this is not in your strength. This is in the strength of Jesus. To him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly all that we can ask or think, to him who is able, not you, but it does say, according to the power that works within me, that works within you. You don't need the perfect words to help somebody mourn. You don't, or to comfort somebody. You don't need any of the, you don't need anything perfect. Jesus is perfect and he'll speak through you. He'll give you wisdom. He'll give you the capability. He'll give you the strength to do these things. So what's my point? My point is this. This power and authority that God has given us is to change the world. We are God's hope for glory, friend. You are God's hope for glory. Not because you know all the scripture, and not because you can quote the Bible frontwards and backwards, and not because you were raised in Jesus. No. The Bible right here, this passage doesn't say, once you know the entire word of God, then I'm going to send you out. Once you've been at church this amount of time, then I'm going to send you out. Once you've known Jesus and you've walked with Jesus and you've gone through all these trials and tribulations, then I'm going to send you out. It does not say that. It just says, I sent you out. I've empowered you. I've equipped you. You are it. You are God's hope for glory. To all who believe, are called and sent out, sons and daughters of the Most High. That's what this power and authority is meant for. So, what is the call to action? What do we do? Where do we go from here, right? We know who we belong to, we know who we are in Christ, and we know what we've been called to do. And what I want to leave with you guys is that to be planted in your revelation of God and who you belong to. Be planted in who you are, in your identity, in this identity, and be planted in what you've been called to do. Have that conviction. And again, know you're not going to do this perfectly. It's not what it's about. It's about doing it in faith. Saying, you know, God, I don't have it all figured out. Even to your friends that need to be comforted and mourned, I don't have it all figured out, but I know the one who does. I don't know about this, but I know who does. I don't have all wisdom, but I know who does. I don't have all the resources, you know, in the world, but I know who does. Oh, the pressure's off, right? Man, sometimes I can easily get overwhelmed. And then God reminds me, Val, I am the gap maker. I am more than enough for you to be utilized by me, a conduit of love. Isn't that amazing? That you can go out and you can change the world around you, not because of perfection, but because of purpose and because of Jesus. I love what it says in Psalms 145, verse 4. Generation after generation stands in awe of your work. Each one tells a story of your mighty acts. This scripture I love because it reminds us that we have to keep sharing our story, keep sharing our testimony, because it's meant to bless others. Again, we've been given all power and authority through Jesus to give glory down to all generations. Keep sharing your testimonies, friend. The Bible says that we will overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. I always thought that was a crazy concept, that my story is in the same verse. It's that we will overcome by the blood of Jesus and by my story. That we will overcome by the blood, the finished work at the cross, and your story. How God saved your marriage. How God saved your prodigal son. How God helped you overcome addiction. How God helped restore your marriage. How God helped you defeat suicide. How God helped you with maybe an autistic child. How God helped your business. How God helped the depression you struggle with. How God helped you overcome pornography. How God helped you with your finances and get out of debt. That we would overcome by the blood of the Lamb, by the finished work of the cross, and by the word of our testimony. That's what we have to keep on sharing. That's what we have to keep on proclaiming the good news to others. It starts with us. So friends, again, you have so much access with his power and authority that is for you because of who you belong to, who you are in Christ, and what you've been called to do. Do not waste it. There was a story that Pastor Ginny, if you don't know her, she's an amazing pastor. She's sharing this story about how she was in Washington, D.C., where they have a church there. And she was gonna get on a train and she was having this hard time. She didn't know the transportation situation and she had all this luggage with her and she was having a hard time. She was alone, traveling alone. And she said she was desperate. I think she even said she was about to cry because she was frustrated. Couldn't find which train to get on and all this stuff. And she had this ticket and she went to one of the workers at the station. And she said, I just need help. I don't know where to go. I don't know what I'm supposed to do. And was telling her story. And I hope I'm doing the story justice. And he looked at her and said, ma'am, your ticket affords you all of these different things. If you would have just taken it, they would have helped you. They would have gotten your luggage on board ahead of time. They would have done all these things for you. And so she shares a story to say that she did not know the access that she had because of this ticket, what it afforded her. And that story always stuck with me because it reminded me that I have this access, this power and authority given to me by Jesus. And I don't want to waste it in this lifetime. This isn't a dress rehearsal. Friend, because Jesus shed his blood on the cross, the finished work at the cross, you have access to healing. You have access to abundance. You have access to purpose. You have access to wisdom. You have access to authority. You have access to so much because of what Jesus purchased for you. Do not waste it just because you didn't know. Just because someone didn't tell you. Which is why we, again, going back to the scripture, let's be conduits of love. Let's help bridge people back to the heart of Jesus so that way they know what they have in this life, in this generation. I love you guys. And again, share this video with somebody who needs hope.